be presenting in English, and I'm going to be presenting a little bit of the history of Hawaii, which is where I come from. So first off, Hawaii, like the state, it's called Hawaii, but it's actually made up of a chain of 8 different islands. The first one being Big Island, and its population is at 186,738 people. And this picture right here is of one of the beaches that you can go there. And I don't know if you can really see, but the sand is actually green.
Yeah.
So it's pretty cool to go there. And if you ever come to Hawaii, you should really go see this beach. So the next island is called Maui, and its population is at 144,444 people. And Maui is not as populated as the other islands, but it is a major tourist attraction, as you can see by the amount of hotels and the big resort that they have there. And also the beaches here are extremely nice. So the next island is where I live, called Oahu. And this island is the most populated out of all the islands, and it is at 953,207 people. And this island is also one of the major tourist attractions because of the fact that it has the Disney Aulani Resort, which is a hotel made from Disney. And it has a lot of different things that you can see, like Diamond Head. You can see this in the picture right here, that island, or that like archipelago, or however it's called. It's called Chinaman's Hat. And there's like a little story about it, that a boy wanted a hat, but it was too big for him. So then he had a hat that was like his precious item, but then he ate these seeds of rice, I think, and he started to grow extremely big because he wanted to impress this girl that he would see every day. But because he grew bigger, no one ever accepted him, so he basically went underneath the water, and he slept for a really long time. And when he woke up, he met these islanders, and they accepted him, and they made him a new hat because his old hat it couldn't fit on his head anymore. And that hat was immensely big, and he wore that hat. And this time, as he grew older, he started getting more tired, and so he went to the bottom of the ocean again, but this time he slept for good, and that is supposedly the hat of the little boy. And this is Kauai, and its population is at 66,921 people. And this island isn't as populated, and it doesn't have as much city life or as much, like, it doesn't have that many structures that are more modern as you would see in Oahu or Big Island. And also, it has a lot of vegetation still. And next is Molokai, and as you can see, the population is getting it's dwindling extremely low because of the fact that the farther you get to the islands, the less people have been there, so there's been less chances to actually populate it and actually build structures, which is why this island only has 7,404 people. And this is Lanai, and this one is one of the 3 least populated islands of Hawaii, with only 3,102 people. And next is Ni'ihau. And this island is actually nicknamed the Forbidden Island.
Why?
Because of the fact that the only people who live on this island, all of those 170 people, are pure Hawaiian. And they're 100% Hawaiian, and they've never traveled out of the island. And
like,
so, because these people are the ones that, when the colonists came from America and from Europe and tried to like destroy our culture and everything that is Hawaii, these are the last remaining few of the people who wanted to keep exactly the same.
Oh, is that exclusion?
Yes.
Yeah.
Separation.
So, I mean, really, like, if you even want to get on the island, it's extremely hard because, one, you need permission from the chief of the island or the person who's, the one in charge. And two, you need to be 100% Hawaiian, too. So, if you were to, if you, like, say, for example, you guys, if you were to come visit Hawaii, you wouldn't be able to get on the island because, well, you're not Hawaiian. But even so, there's still been some cases where there's been pure Hawaiian people who have tried to come onto the island and they still restrict them, their access.
You cannot go
there? No,
even
I cannot go.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, as you can see, it's really small.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not able to go too.
I like the word forbidden. You know how people are forbidden?
Yeah.
Let's go.
And then this is Kaho'olawe, and this one is actually uninhabited.
Okay.
So this is like a really virgin island, and there's no buildings, there's no people, there's just strictly mountain ranges, there's lush vegetation, forest, and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And next is, I'm going to talk about the one of the first people who colonized Hawaii, and this was actually like 1500 years back. The first people who came to these islands before they were known as Hawaii were Polynesians from the Marquesas and Marquesas Islands, and they actually, it was almost as if they discovered the islands by accident, because they had no maps. They had no way of knowing that they would arrive at islands. All they used to navigate was the stars and just their skills as navigators. Because back in these times, 1500 years ago, the Polynesians were considered the masters of the sea because of the fact that, as opposed to other navigators during their time, they didn't need maps. They didn't need any sort of navigational equipment. All they needed to do was look to the sky and the stars and follow, what the stars told them. So most of that history, though, sadly, it's lost, we can't really figure it out, because the Hawaiians from that time, they had no written, they had no writing style or writing system. All they had was chants, dances, which is called hula, and legends, which is how they would pass down their history from generation to generation. But because of the fact that many kahunas, which is what we call like the chiefs or the kahunas, are the wisest, is the wisest person of the village. So because many of them died already, and they didn't get the chance to pass down those legends or the chants, which in turn, they didn't get to pass on their history to the other generations. And however, their history is at least still preserved today in the form of hula dances, chants, legends, and rituals, and a lot of cultural things that we still practice today on the islands. And that's more mainly the ancient history, and the more modern history that you would experience now started when Captain James Cook first arrived at the islands. Because, I mean, like, a really common misconception is that James Cook discovered Hawaii, but he didn't. All he did was arrive at the islands of Kauai and Niihau back in 1778. So when he arrived, he brought with him everything that you would see today, because he came from Europe, which was obviously a far more advanced country at the time. So he brought with him the cattle, he brought with him livestock, technology, and also he brought with him a new religious faith that they thought they needed to practice, because the Hawaiians of old, they practiced polytheism and animism. And what that means is that they believed in many gods and goddesses, and they thought that every single thing, whether it was living or non-living, had a soul or had a spirit in them. But when they came, they wanted to take that out, and they told them, there's only one God, you just pray to this one God, and that's it, and go to church every Sunday. And so what happened, though, was that in 1810, a king, or the person who would become king, who was known as Kamehameha, he united the different factions of Hawaii, because at this time, Hawaii was split up into different villages and different factions, which are called Ahupuakas, and it's basically a slice of land that goes from mountain to sea, and all of that belongs to one village or one community. And those different villages were fighting against each other for power. So what Kamehameha did is he united all of those into one kingdom. But sadly, when he died, 10 years later, Protestant missionaries came to the islands, and they decided to enforce all of these different rules and regulations that they needed to follow. And well, they could, because their weapons were far more advanced than the Hawaiians, and they had more so a technological advantage over them. So then, in 1898, these American colonists were, at the time, they had already controlled their economy, and they turned them into a territory of the U.S. And then later in 1956, I believe, Hawaii turned into a state, as we know it now. So this is some of the culture. And so, as I was saying, the old culture, back 1500 years ago, and before James Cook arrived, they worshipped many different goddesses and gods, and they believed that for a lot of different reasons, they would have to give them offerings, whether it was food, whether it was something personal to you, whether it was something sacred. You had to give an offering. Let's say if you wanted to go to what they referred to as a sacred temple, you would have to go there and give an offering to the god or goddess of that temple and pray to them. And there's also this event. It was sort of like summer break for them, because they would work all year, and this event was summer break for them. It's called Makahiki, and before they would start Makahiki, they would pray to all the gods, and they would pray that their crops would grow, that there would be no droughts or anything, and they would be able to have fun, because that's what they did during Makahiki. They played games, they had festivals, they had competitions, and yeah, it was just a lot of fun. And so some more of the modern culture is, well, ever since immigrants and missionaries came to Hawaii, our culture began to change drastically, because it was people of different ethnicities coming together and trying to understand one another, because you would have Chinese people trying to talk with Mexican people who at the same time are working along with Japanese people who have to work with Portuguese people or Filipinos or even Native Hawaiians. And so because of all of this interaction, a unique culture came into being, which is what you would see now if you came to Hawaii. And a lot of that is shared with food. And food is a major thing in Hawaii, because through food, you can see the blend of different cultures, because you have, for example, blends of a Japanese dish with a Hawaiian dish, or a Mexican dish with a Japanese dish. So, yeah.
We don't have that. We don't have
it. So,
you know this way.
Yeah. So you see a lot of these different cultures being brought together as one through food and just through all this communication. And also, values, morals, and tradition are three of the major things that people in Hawaii respect and follow through the most. And yeah, it's something you wouldn't really experience quite the same way in any other place in the world. And this is just some of the food and things you would see in Hawaii.
That's the one I said, that's pao soupy.
What is that purple thing?
I'm hungry.
This is called poi. So poi is made from a plant called taro. And it grows, like really big, and so you pound it up and mash it into what you see right there, poi.
Does it taste good?
Yeah, it does.
Of course, it tastes bad.
I don't know if you would try it, but to me, when I first tried it, it actually tasted like free hollis.
Like, okay. Don't forget to mention to them that Obama was born there.
And then these are called manapours, and it's basically just bread filled with meat, and it can be any type of meat. It could be chicken, it could be pork, or even duck. They have duck in there too. And these are called manasara, and those ones are just, it's a type of pastry.
Huh? How are they called?
Manasadas. So it's a type of pastry that it's just... No, that's not the
same. I'm hungry, sorry. But ignore me.
Wait, what am I talking about? Do you know a comedian named Luffy?
Yeah.
That's Iglesias.
Gabriel Iglesias.
Hansophie Iglesias.
He has a joke.
All this food that you see in this one, that's what you would normally see out of luau, which in Hawaii is, it's basically just like a really big get together that you invite all your friends, all your family, all your relatives, and it starts off as a get together where you eat and have fun, and it turns into a party, and they have dances, they have songs, or whatever else you can imagine. And then this up here is called poke, and that's essentially it's just raw fish with seasoning. You can add salsa to it if you want. It has lemon and salt. And yeah, and over there we have hula dancers, and that's actually at right where they're dancing is a big it's a big competition called the Merry Monarch Festival. And what that is it happens once a year, and it's where a lot of different hula teams or hula dancers get together to compete for the first spot. And you don't just see female hula dancers, there's also men who dance hula, and they also demonstrate with their dances, they demonstrate stories and legends that you would normally have seen in part of like old Hawaii.